showrunner, Mr. Scott Gimple. Dave Alpert. Executive producer Gale Anne Hurd. And executive producer and the guy who has a mountain of Emmys for his work, special effects on The Walking Dead, Mr. Greg Nicotero. Welcome! It feels like we just did this, and now we're here again, already for Comic-Con. Let's talk a little bit about where we left off last season, what we're going to see. I feel like each season you always say, like, I know where we were this season, but next season is going to get crazier. Can you confirm that that is the case between the two seasons this time?
Oh yeah, definitely. Things are definitely going to be way crazier. I mean, it's an escalation. The world is getting worse. The people are getting more ragged. There's more terrible things happening, and they're having to deal with them. And it's going to keep progressing, if you can believe it. Yeah.
Yeah, it's getting crazier. How's it been for you so far, Scott?
It has escalated. It's been crazy. We did the first episode. I wrote it, and Greg directed it, and just right out of the gate, the things that we did just blew my mind. I mean, it's going to get insane very quickly.
But how do you, Nicotero, what's the challenge with it? Like, how do you guys, because the show's already done insane stuff, so how do you go, next year, we're going to do this? Like, you as a special effects guy and executive producer, what types of things are you doing to ensure that that will happen?
Well, you know, we learn at the end of every season. We fine-tune things, we revise the walker makeups, puppets, animatronics, stuff like that. You know, Scott and I have collaborated. He wrote the episode last year where Merle dies that I directed. So we collaborate really well together and really sort of fine-tuned. The writers are doing a great job of sort of writing even more original gags into the storyline. So there's stuff that we shot in the last 2 weeks that are above and beyond stuff.
Actually, on Thursday morning.
Yeah, Thursday, 24 hours ago, we shot one of the coolest Walker gags ever.
So. Is everyone caught up on Walking Dead?
Woo!
If
you're not,
I just ruined the season 3.
So. You will be spoiled.
If not, Merle dies. Sorry. You should know that if you're the Walking Dead fan.
Oh, did I say? Oh, I'm mad.
Oh, whoops. Gale, the show has been like your family for the last few years. And you've had to say goodbye to people, you've seen new people come in, you know, cast-wise, so what's the feeling like this season, each year, how does it get more special?
It's funny, the first day of principal photography, when it was, you know, 95 degrees and 90% humidity, everyone got together, 150 cast and crew, in a big huddle, and went, like, go team. It's like we are in the Super Bowl, and we want to bring the best season ever for the fans, and that's our goal. So thank you for your support.
I mean, it's been sort of emotional for you guys too, because like again, you know, we bring people on, we get attached to them, we have to say goodbye to them, you know.
But they never leave, honestly. I mean, we did a field trip because Sarah Wayne Callies, who played Lori, was in a play at the Kennedy Center in Washington, D.C. We did a field trip from set to go see her and surprise her on her opening night. You know, that's true. Once you're part of the show, you can't get rid of us.
Yeah, I mean, we talked to John Bernthal all the time, and I was in New York at the end of March and had dinner with Jeff DeMunn. And I was like, oh, God, he's still alive, thank God. You know, like, I thought that Dale was so long ago, but it was nice to see him.
In your head, you killed him.
I did kill him physically. I ripped his stomach open, but, you know, fortunately, he got better.
So yeah, he's
they're all still alive.
You know that stuff's all fake, right, Greg?
It's not fake to Nicotero. It's all real.
No, it was real.
David, what about you?
Yeah, honestly, the challenge of seeing people that you care about sort of written off the show, I think, drives the writers to come up with more justifications for the actions that they come up with. And I think that's really what the show is all about, is that since everybody's on the table pretty much every episode, you really you really have to sort of make sure you're adhering to a rigid logic that makes sense and gives a rhythm and internal logic to the show. And I think that's really what the show's all about for us.
I'm going all the way to, from the point that he started becoming the governor and doing those things, he received a great deal of positive reinforcement for all of the rough things that he did.
Yeah.
The world was telling him, this is cool, you have what it takes, until episode 316. He received some negative reinforcement, and that's going to affect the character.
I mean, without sort of being tethered to a community or having the justification of, I'm doing this for the good of the people, which obviously he clung to for so long. Now it's just, are all bets off with him? Is that what we're to expect from that in the next
episode? Yeah, absolutely. All bets are off.
All bets are seriously off.
Yeah, he's still out there, but, you know, how he returns, when he returns, or what he's doing when he returns is going to be a pretty big mystery this season.
Yeah. Well, you guys have a clip that...
Do we have a clip? I thought we weren't doing a clip.
Well, you have a trailer.
Scott?
Oh, it's not a clip.
Do you guys want to see it?
October 13th, 9 p.m. 8 Central, which means that Talking Dead will be on 10 p.m. Right afterwards this year. So let's bring the cast out now. Slipped away, or do you feel like there's still a little something left to salvage?
I think that the relationship with Carl is integral to the beginning of this season, certainly from Rick, and him turning into a sociopath at the end of the season definitely woke him up, you know, for his parenting duties. So yeah, I think you find Rick in a completely new place at the beginning of this season. He's trying to repress his brutality, and he's renounced quite a lot of responsibilities and leadership for the sake of his children. So yeah, it's a completely, certainly for me, it was a very different experience beginning this season.
Yeah. What about you, Danai? I mean, you know, what happened with Andrea? You started to see the end of last season was shown really warming up to everyone, and then this horrible thing happens at the end, and you know, where do you think that leaves her emotionally?
Well, I think the great thing was that, you know, she had actually
actually started to become part of a community. And the beautiful thing that Andrea gives to her as she's dying is she says it's great that you found them. And there is that understanding that, you know, you found a group of people, the group that I spoke to you about, the group that I trusted myself with, and now you're a part of them. And I think that was a kind of a parting thing between them that was affirming that Michelle was in the right place.
Can she have room for emotions? Do you think she can still be the sort of lawyer that she needs to be, and but still let people...
She's in? Every woman, babe. You know, she has room for all that. You know, great. Women have a lot of capacity for a lot of things, and I think she's finding, you know, she's having to open up her capacity she has that she's sort of shut down, but yeah, she's got space for that.
Have you found it any easier, like, the physical demands? Because when we talked last year, you were like, it's been pretty intense, you know, just what the show has you do. So how are you feeling as an actor with the physical part?
You know, no, it doesn't get easier.
No?
You know, which is great. You know, you kept on your toes. I mean, the beauty of it is, you know, as, you know, Greg was saying, like, the gags and the experiences of the characters, it just gets more and more intense. It's just more and more interesting stuff they come up with. So you have to pivot, you have to adjust, and your body has to do new things.
Yeah.
Like, I've never ridden a horse before, so that was new to my body as well. But, like, just all sorts of different things just, you know, are thrown at you, and you gotta move with it. So, no, you don't get comfortable.
Yeah. Not about
this show.
I want to ask Steven. See, Glenn had a really interesting sort of emotional journey this past season. He kind of... What was that?
He said something.
Oh, what do you mean he's lucky? Yes! Oh, because of Maggie, yes.
That's true.
You sort of heckled Glenn. You knew these are not... It's not a documentary. The Walking Dead's a scripted show.
She just clapped his mouth shut.
He means well. But I feel like Glenn sort of went through this kind of, he was trying to process all of his emotions about what happened between the governor and Maggie, and kind of became a little selfish in a way, and, you know, sort of pulled it out at the end. What do you think was going on with him?
Yeah, you know, that was just, I love Glenn because he's constantly evolving, kind of like someone evolves just even in the regular world. You know, you're learning a lot of life lessons, and he happened to go through a really terrible one with the person that he truly, truly loves and cares about, and might be the sole reason why he's still alive. And when that is tarnished in front of him, he doesn't know how to handle it. He doesn't realize that there's a hurt person that he needs to help through. Instead, all he sees is vengeance and how I can take care of it myself, and he puts her to the wayside. And I think that was a really great arc to play, considering it shows this young man's growth into learning each life lesson, even along with, you know, Herschel teaching that lesson in response.
It's kind of a weird thing, and I think it's a guy thing, where it's like, you're so focused on, I gotta get vengeance to the guy who wronged this person that I care about, that you actually end up pushing that person aside and just become obsessed with your own vengeance.
Oh yeah, totally, we're just self-centered. Guys are just self-centered.
It's true.
I would say mostly.
I was thinking about myself, I'm sorry. Lauren,
he's forgiven now.
He's forgiven, yes. Oh, we saw the scene where he was forgiven. That was very nice forgiveness on your part. If only everyone could be so forgiving. But what it, you know, it almost seems like that Maggie was dealing with what happened with the governor better than Glenn was dealing with it. What did you see from her point of view during those episodes?
Yeah, I think that Maggie wanted to move on a little faster, and she knew the way that women do, that it's better to just kind of live in that moment and to not spoil what they have saved by the vengeance or the regret. And interestingly, all that from the governor and all the sort of torture and challenges that Maggie went through last year propelled a whole new journey for her this year. So it was a very good springboard for a stronger cat.
Do you think this kind of a relationship that they have in this world is essential to survival, or do you think it's detrimental to have those kinds of deep emotional...
I think it's a choice. I definitely think it's a choice, and I think that Maggie and Glenn have had a chance to let it test the relationship, and I think that when we see them again this season, we're going to see that it's something that strengthens them. So I think it can definitely go either way.
Okay, this is for Scott, who has travels and sort of, Herschel's sort of become the moral compass of the group now, and so how do you feel that his evolution or his role within the group might change in the fourth season? Do you think that's going to grow, or at a certain point is it going to be like, ah, screw it, do whatever you guys want?
I said this earlier today, I think he really just wants to hold on to his other leg.
That's his motivation?
That's his motivation. But I think the whole group is so interconnected and so dependent on each other. It's really, really wonderful to see how everyone does react to each other. So he has a part in that, so I feel very happy that I've been a part of it. Will continue to be until whatever happens.
I'd also like to have a hand for Chad Coleman, who this is his first panel. Important character in the comics and someone that people wanted to see, and you're finally him.
Yeah.
And so.
Yeah, I am.
So, how did it feel coming into this group that was already sort of formed? You know, did you kind of slide right in, or was there an adjustment period, or how do you as an actor fit into the group, and then where do you think Tyrese fits in?
Well, as an actor, you know, this is an amazing group of folks, as I said before, with a lot of integrity, talent, and artistry, and any actor would want to be in that home with the type of writing and the performances and the production. So, you know, it's a high level, and it's where any actor would want to live. You know, these are the challenges you want. You want actors who inspire you, writers who inspire you, you know, and you want to be a part of something that fans appreciate on the level that you guys do. So as far as that's concerned, man, these guys welcomed me with open arms, and I'm grateful for that. As far as Tyrese, on a certain level, you know, Tyrese is still trying to find out how he fits in, you know, and like what are the rules of engagement for him, you know, in this dilapidated world we're living in, and you know, how to negotiate, you know, his place in his family and how to negotiate the outside world is crashing in. So I think he's still trying to find out, you know, find his footing.
For all intents and purposes, he seems like he's a good guy and he's motivated to try to do the right thing. But how do you think you figure out what that is when the sort of moral and ethical axis of the world is not the same?
Absolutely. I mean, that's the question that he's plagued with. I don't get the sense that he's, you know, gratuitous violence, you know. I sense that he really needs a strong reasoning behind why he does what he does, but this world just won't let him operate that way. And, you know, no one goes unscathed, and eventually, you know, can of whoop-ass might get popped up.
All right, so this is for David Morrissey down at the end. Whenever we sort of do these panels and have these, I'm over here! Whenever we do these panels and have these talks, and it would sort of come up like, someone would say, oh, the governor's a bad guy, or the governor's a villain, you would be kind of offended. You'd be like, no, he's not.
No, he's not.
But wait a minute. Some shit happened at the end of last season that I think would indicate the contrary to your statement. Has he finally broken, do you think?
Well, you know, I mean, I think at the end of last season he was in a very dark place and he sort of did some bad things, turned on his own people, but he feels like they betrayed him, you know, and that's just not going to go down well with the governor, you know? So he just has to sort of take it in hand, but I mean, he went off with two of them, he didn't kill them all.
Oh, okay, you're right, I'm sorry.
So, you know, you've got to give him a break there.
How about all the eggs he didn't break, how about that?
Yeah, well... He just
just got to be on my side. If you're not on my side, you just got to go. You know, that's the thing. That's the deal with a gun, you know.
Damn it, you're still so charming, even when you're saying horrible things. Where do you think emotionally, you know, let's say before you started shooting the next season and you kind of knew where everything was going, where did you think he was going to go after that? Where can that guy go from that point?
Well, that's the question. I mean, I think even in 316, we saw him at the immediate aftermath of what he did, and I think, you know, it was a very spontaneous action. It was like he went into trauma. It was something happened to him, something switched. I mean, he wasn't a particularly rational man before that, but I mean, you know, just as he's thwarted in his desire is to take the prison. It doesn't work, and he sees his soldiers sort of running away, turning the back on him, and he has to do something. And a switch goes off in his head, and I think what we do is we see him dealing with what that switch is. What is it in him and around him that makes that switch go down, and he has to deal with that.
Yeah. So this is for Norman. We saw Daryl a tremendous amount of growth and integration into the community. Honestly, I got choked up with that scene with you and Murrow where you're defending Glenn. You're like, he's Korean, man. I was like, stop it, you're killing me. Like, it was such a lovely moment. He's really become a part of the group, and seeing the juxtaposition of him to Murrow shows how far Daryl's actually come. What was that like for you?
Yeah, when I read the script with Merle dying, I thought, man, this day is going to suck, you know. But the thing is, he was sort of doomed to become Mini Merle, you know, and I wanted to play him like I grew up, embarrassed that he's racist and that he takes drugs and stuff. And, you know, without Merle around, he can sort of find this sense of self-worth that he never would have found if this apocalypse didn't happen. So, you know, the relationships he has with these people is the glue that keeps him there. He doesn't need to be there. He can hunt, he can find his own food, he can protect himself. But these people are this family, you know, that he never had before. But he's definitely grown up a ton. I mean, all the characters, and it's super interesting to be on the inside and see what everybody brings to these characters, because nobody's the same as they were in the first season, you know? So it's a real delight for me.
Yeah, so for Andy, obviously I think there's a risk of getting to a point in that world where you don't want to let new people in. And essentially what you've done at the end of last season is just let a ton of new people in that you don't know who they are. And so you kind of have to trust at that point.
I think so, and I think the death of Andrea combined with what happened with my son, with Carl, definitely was the catalyst to bring him to that point. And he realized that the brutality and pushing people away of season three really wasn't working for him. It was sort of cataclysmic for his family. And I think when we meet them all in season four, there is a whole new community in the prison, and an incredible friction and tension between certain characters, and it makes for incredible character-driven scenes, and it's been great.
Danai, at this point in the lives of the characters, is there any shred of hope? And if there is, what is that? Or do you think they're just like day-to-day, they're surviving? Will they ever get to be comfortable again?
I mean, I think it's really interesting how, you know, the melding of the communities occurring and what that all means. I think the hope is in so many things. I think the hope is in the beauty of Beth singing. The hope is in the beauty of that little baby girl. The hope is in Carl. The hope is in so many components of how a community is melding and moving forward, regardless of the ugliness of the world around them. And I think that just represents something that people want to preserve and protect.
And definitely, whenever the characters start to get comfortable is when I always get the most nervous, because that's when Kirkman likes to go, let's shake the box!
As you should. I mean, one thing I'll guarantee you is expect the unexpected, and you'll never really get comfortable. So, don't try.
And at this point, it really is like the humans are the ones to really fear from now on. It's like the walkers are, you know, they're essentially animals at this point, right?
Oh, really? Oh, okay.
No, I don't. But a walker can't can't turn on you. You know what's coming at you, you know?
Well, I mean, you know, I think that the walkers are walkers, and we know that they are, you know, a threat. You have to handle them, and there are times, you know, handling them might take you by surprise exactly how you have to, so...
I don't know if you saw that trailer.
Yeah, I did. I was sorry. Yeah.
So yeah, the walkers are no threat at all this season.
No.
I guess you just kind of tuned out.
You could just change the title to Angry People. So you're my boss. Okay, I'll do.
Would anyone else like to host Talking Dead?
Oh shit.
I'm taking out.
What are you, the internet? What are you, Reddit? We want to open up the floor to fan questions. We're going to have a nice chunk of time to answer those, and I know there's a lot, so let's just get it going. Hi.
Run to the mic.
Hi.
What's your name?
Sky.
Hi, Sky. What's your question?
It's for Robert and Andrew and maybe Danai. I was just wondering if, you know, since Andrea is dead in the book now, and they are, I mean, in the show.
A few people out there were worried just now.
And they were still together in the book. Is there a possibility that Michonne and Rick can get together?
Oh, she basically wants to play Walking Dead Matchmaker.
Yeah, what do you guys think of that? Does that sound like a good plan?
Oh my God, they're sitting right next to each other. What does it mean? What does it mean? It's a clue.
We're playing footsie.
Anything is possible.
Yes. What's your name? What's your question?
Oh, hi, my name is Muriel.
Hi, Muriel.
I have a question for Danai and Norman. Pretty much the end of the season, you guys lost someone really close to you, and I was wondering, especially since you guys are so, I don't want to say unemotional, but...
Yes, we're getting together.
No, it's Rick and Michonne. Anyways.
That's decided.
She just wrote it.
It's fan fiction. I was wondering, how do you think that's going to drive your guys' characters in the next season, since the deaths happened so close in the end of this last season?
Ben, you want to go? Look how cute she is. Yeah, I mean, everyone's losing people left and right, but, you know, both those characters are sort of loner characters, or it's, you know, learning to deal with a group and be part of a group, so I think it'll just bring us closer together, and, you know, then we'll get together. And maybe Rick can join? Sorry,
being written. That's a fan fiction that's actually being written.
Why would you do that?
I've read that one.
No, let's all just take a second and picture it. Oh, there it is.
Let's move on.
Hi, what's your name? What's your question?
Hi, my name is Jill. And Rishon all the way. But my question is, Andrew, what place did you go to in the scene where you find out about Lori's death? It kind of broke my heart a little bit. So I was just wondering, are you method? Like, what place did you go to?
You know, the only bad thing about this show is the fact that we get to work with amazing actors, make amazing friendships, and then they get bitten and I shoot them. So, but, you know, I think this is the first time that I've done a show that's done 3 years, and you don't only grieve missing a friendship, but you're never going to have those scenes again with those characters, and that's an incredibly sort of sad thing to happen. And all I don't know what method means, but I just listen to a lot of music, and I didn't really, I try and see what happens, and because it was such an extraordinary script and moment, I just sort of, I don't really know, it's very difficult to explain, but I just got into a place and then sort of let myself alone, really. And the kid was, Chandler was amazing. Because he looked at me, there was one look that kind of broke my heart. And, you know, you always bring part of yourself to a character. And, you know, I have a wife, I have two children. And, you know, when a child looks at you and confirms the death of your, one of the most important human beings in your life, it sounds like I am method, actually, halfway through this answer, but it completely floored me. I mean, I said to the director that I wanted to start in one place. I wanted him to drop his gun. I wanted to see a man that had been leading these people fall apart and fall down physically. And that was the thing that unlocked that moment and made me go to my knees. And, you know, that's pretty much... Well, that's as much as I can remember.
you feel like Rick's back, right? I mean, it was a little touch and go there for a few episodes where it seemed like he was loosely tethered to reality.
Yeah, and I think that Scott and everybody's touched upon it is that we, by circumstance, these human beings are thrown together and become this. I was going to say fucking then, but...
That's a good thing you didn't say it.
Because it says, please be aware that members of your audience may be under 18 years of age.
That doesn't matter, they have the internet next to us.
But it's, you get pulled through. I think one of my favorite things about the show is that you get pulled through different times by different characters. And you get this incredible unity. The I in love is the kind of heart, the beating heart of the show. And Herschel, all of these characters, Michonne, the burgeoning relationship and romance between Rick and Michonne.
Which was just announced at Comic-Con.
Yeah, that's just happened. Now, these things, you know, are the... I agree, I think he's been pulled out of this terrible place, you know, by these human beings.
Right. Okay, next question. Hi, what's your name?
Noella.
What's your question?
So the last season, we see like how Lori passes, and like we all know that you guys are like a tight-knit group. Like, how does the whole cast feel when one of the characters has to make an exit?
I can't really ask David Morrissey because he killed a lot of them.
I didn't know she was dead.
I mean, my experience, because it was, you know, being very close to Andrea, as much as Michonne was, the beauty of it was that Laurie Holden did indoctrinate me into The Walking Dead. It was just me and her at the beginning. And she was a dear indoctrinator, and it was beautiful to learn this world through her. So, it is not the easiest experience. The beauty of this show is that, amazingly, its structure is that people come and go, and that structure works. And so there's something, you know, like you understand it artistically, and so you go with what, you know, happens. But it is always very hard, and I think it's hard even as a human being, and it translates into your character, and they beautifully interweave that into how we end up moving forward as a group. So, but yeah, it's hard. Yes.
You know, we have a screening room at the studio in Georgia, and every actor that has died on the show, we've retired their cast number and put a photo of them up on the wall. It's like retiring their jersey. So every day when we have meetings in that room, we see all the photos of all the actors that have perished on the show.
The Grateful Dead.
Yeah, and it's called The Grateful Dead. We have a little thing up on the wall. But we see them every day, so it's like they're always still kind of around.
I called it the Hall of Name.
Yes, what's your question?
Firstly, I'd like to give a high five from the Min State to Steven.
Oh, hey! Yeah!
Go Katie Zoo!
Are you from Kalamazoo?
No, I'm from East Lansing.
Oh, nice! What's up? Is anybody... Okay. Hi.
Okay, my question is, what do you like most about playing characters that are morally and physically evolving as the story arc progresses?
That's a good question for
Sam. I'm very lucky to play this character for multiple reasons, but one important part is the fact that, you know, the stark difference between season one Glenn and season three Glenn and the continual evolution of Glenn even into season four. And it's, for me as an actor's dream, to be able to do as many different things as I've been able to do. I've been able to play like kind of the comic relief or the quirky weird kid, and then I've been able to play you know, the action scenes, and then also play the hyper emotional and the love scenes. It's been really awesome. And so, like kind of Danai said, there's this magic that happens with you and your character, especially with television, that you, you're with your character for so long over the course of such a long story that you start finding parallels to real life and how the story goes in the show. So an instance would be, you know, when Daryl, or when Dale goes, that was rough for Glenn, because I only imagined how many conversations that Glenn and Dale had in the RV about how to fix things, or what books to read, or just little tidbits of knowledge. And the amazing thing is Jeff did the same thing for me. So we would have dinners, just him and I, and I remember he bought me a bunch of Shakespeare, and he was like, read this, and study this. And to me, when he left, I remember I was really nervous for that scene where I had to, it was me and Lori Holden at the RV, and I was like, oh man, I don't know if I can conjure up this type of emotion. But then it was just, boom, like waterworks, like so easy, because all I had to do was play the moment, which is Dale is gone, but Jeff is gone, and it was so brutal. So it's this crazy journey that I think all of us take, and everyone evolves, and I think that's the beauty of the show, for I think the audience to latch onto one character and say, oh, I'm that guy, and then just follow his evolution, and beautiful for us, because we get to play everything. It's awesome.
I like the distinction between season one Glenn and season three Glenn, because season one Glenn is sort of like, oh, he's this kind of nerdy kid, and he's, you know, like, he's, you can tell he's brave, but he's still a little scared of the world. And then season three is like, no, come on, seriously. Seriously. There's that scene, the scene where Merle throws the walker in and you're just, you, the chair, was not only a performance, but also the physical performance was fantastic. So how did you, have you been training? How did you get prepared for that?
You know what's cool is, like, it's in the same regard, the parallels with real life. Remnants of the past inform your future. So John, actually, before I got into the third season, when he was exiting, he was like, yo, you gotta come work out of my gym, man. He boxes.
Is that John Bernthal impersonation?
Yo, bro. Yo, you gotta box, bro. That's how he talks.
It's uncanny.
Yeah, it's really good. He's from cartoons. He was like, you need to work out at my gym, and it'd be fun to just box. And I got into it, and it just kind of follows suit that way. So, you know, past characters come into real life to inform your evolution. It's all really...
Yes, sir, what's your question?
How challenging is it to describe the theme and message of each character, especially Rick's character, since he's the central character in such a great ensemble?
That sounds more like a writer's
answer. How difficult is it to describe the theme?
Rick's back, one more time.
I'm sorry, sir.
You know, just on the show, how difficult is it to show each character's human side and their message for the show?
I think it's really the basis of their story, you know? I mean, what you're talking about is their human side, who they are, what they want in this world. That's where you start. And the I guess the hard part is, where does it go from there? But the big thing in the show is we have this amazing ensemble, we have this amazing group of characters, and where it goes from there is they affect each other. What their priorities are in this world, how this world changes them, that makes them change each other. It's just having these guys bounce off each other for 16 episodes and see where they wind up.
I also think that it starts there. You know, everything starts from where the character's going. It's not like, oh, wouldn't it be cool if we threw a walker at somebody? No, it starts from like, okay, where is Rick? Where's Michonne? Where are these characters going? Where are they coming from? And once we figure that out, and then we can plot out what action sort of happens to sort of drive their story.
Okay. Oh, look, the Walking Dead cast is going to ask the Walking Dead cast a question.
Wow.
Yeah. It's
Our question is,
very docile walkers behind you, just standing there politely.
We taught them how to be tame. So our question is that when the zombie apocalypse really does happen, how would you guys deal with it? Are you guys prepared?
No. Wait, I'm sorry, are you guys triplets? The walkers in the back?
No, they're just walkers. They all...
Am I being Asian against my own, racist?
Well, you are being Asian, yes. You are definitely being Asian.
I do something stupid up here every year.
You don't have to be walker racist, but like, that's not cool. They were individuals.
It looks
Steven.
My bad, everyone in Asia. Alright, what was the question?
The question is, the question was, how would you, I remember when you came on our podcast, you were like, I would just hang myself, because this is a horrible world to live in.
I regret answering that, because I do get this question a lot, so I'm oftentimes saying, oh, I would kill myself. And I'm like, I'm not like a depressed guy, I don't know that I would do that, but it seems like the thing to do if you did have to face living in this world.
Yeah.
I wouldn't want to be fighting zombies all day long and, you know, being scared. And scared doesn't sound fun.
No, not so. You wouldn't want to live in this world that you created. It's too.
No. I think I would have to. I don't know if I'd hang myself. I'd probably jump off a high place because then you'd like have that free fall sensation.
Oh yeah.
So that like, sounds fun.
2 seconds of wee, and then yeah. It's over.
Oh, I should have done some parachuting before I got to this.
Andy, what about you? Do you feel like you are prepared for the impending apocalypse?
I would like to think not. I'd be useless, actually. But Chandler Riggs, on the other hand, yes. Who sadly can't be here, but he's grown up. This boy is a beast now, and his voice is about an octave lower than when you last saw him. I've actually got to drop my voice in scenes now to make it match. But yeah, I'd stand behind Chandler Riggs.
What about you, Norman? What would you do with the apocalypse?
I would take over a hotel, spray paint myself silver, run around in circles naked, and watch South Park.
Park is still on. Like somehow they managed to keep it alive, Matt and Trey. Thank you, Walking Dead cast. Yes, what is your name, sir?
I want to ask a question to Andrew and David. One of my favorite moments in last season was when Rick and the governor meet each other and try to reach a compromise, but Rick doesn't want to give up prison, and the governor wants to get the prison anyway. How did you guys feed off each other's intensity? Like, with the governor's violence inside him and Rick's dealing with his wife's death and...
Yeah, let's
keep that intense.
David,
let's start with David. So basically you have these two alpha males who are being territorial at each other. So how did you guys use that energy in your work?
Well, first of all, when the script arrived, I came on the show because I was such a huge fan of the show and the actors in it, and then I got here and there's quite a lot of them I didn't get to work with. I didn't get to work with Norman and Andy as well. And then when that scene came, I was like, great, I get to work with Andy. That was my big thing. I wanted to work with him so much, and here it was. And also, the scene was so well written. And unusually for us, it was in one location. You know, we weren't rushing around everywhere, so we had a bit more time with that scene. But we never talked to each other. We never talked to each other outside of doing the lines, you know, actually being in the scene. We sort of ran it a bit, but we didn't have much chat outside of the scene itself. You know, we sort of kept ourselves to ourselves. And I remember it was a bit like doing a play. It was a bit like, you know, there we were, we knew the lines and we just ran it. And David, who directed it, was wonderful and sort of, you know, filmed us doing it. But it felt like a little bit more like being in the theater, really. But it was for me, it was just a great chance to work with Andrew Lincoln, who I've been a friend of for a long time, but I've found out for even longer, and it was just great to be in a scene with him, finally, so that's what it was like for me.
What about you?
Pretty much the same thing. It was we just left ourselves alone, and it was kind of edgy that day, and there was quite a good energy on the set, which was, you know, combative. And funny enough, a lot of the crew were wearing crew shirts that had sort of Rick Grimes on the back as well. So there was this bit of sort of,
well, they were not.
Yes, they were.
They were
five.
Was
five no. Rick Grimes. There were five.
They all had a patch on.
See, this is what I'm talking about.
My memory is they had a patch on. Even the DOP when he was doing it.
And David just pulls the gun that's taped under the panel.
I was so angry about that gun, because I could see it every take. I was like, gun on, man.
Yes, that's the next one. Up to one more question.
Hi, Chris.
If there's one person at Comic-Con who really stands out above the rest, I think we know it's Button Lady. Every time we're just throwing the last nail. In this one, Button Lady, what is your question?
My question's for David. Oh my god, I love Blackpool. I was wondering if you could convince the writing staff to write in a scene where you could sing, maybe just before, like a melancholy song, just before Carl kills you.
Just before what happens?
So reasonable.
People are like people are just getting up and like, okay, so here's where you're gonna go with the show, and then you guys figure it out.
There is an internet phenomenon, which is, I'm sure you've seen, which is the bad lip syncing.
Do it, Dave.
Chance the governor singing, but I can't really see a crossover between Blackpool and The Walking Dead. That would be a really strange hybrid. I think the governor's not gonna burst into song soon. Certainly not doing any dancing. But you never know.
What did you think when you said? What did you think when you first saw the bad lip reading? It was genius.
I thought it was great. I mean, it was great. I thought it was done in the best. With great love for the show as well. So yeah, but it was fun to see it because it's such a heavy show, and we do real tough emotions, so to see some lightness, that was great for somebody else to do that. But it was fun. My kids got a real buzz out of it, so that was good.
David, sing it.
You should sing it now.
Sing it.
Yeah, just one. Please help me in thanking the executive producers and the cast of The Walking Dead. Thank you guys so much for waiting. If you waited all day, and we'll see you on the weekend. Have fun at the con today.
Thank you.